Today on Typical Books, we're talking about horror books coming out in September and a few coming out in August too, because I skipped over that when I did a summer video of this nature. So back to monthly now. There's a lot of really cool books coming out in September. I think I have 16 books to talk about, and there's maybe too many. So I will have a patron poll up soon to pick a book, because there's a few that I want here. One I really thought I wanted and I'm undecided now, so maybe I'll put that in the poll as well. But I did already pick up, something came out in August, Garbology. Criminality Presents Garbology, a anthology of awesome trash, and it is a trashy book collection, a trashy short story collection written by quite a few booktubers and a lot of authors and a lot of new voices, especially to me. 34 authors, 10 artists, 5 countries, 3 continents, crime, pulp, horror, that kind of thing. If you watch Criminality's channel, you will know that that is the catchphrase that warms our hearts. So yeah, really pleased to see this. Adults Only is one of the sections. Crime Doesn't Pay is another of the chapters or the sections or books in this collected work of anthologies. Monster Mash, Weird Menace, and When Animals Attack. So it's got a lot of things going on there. It is maybe a little extreme at times. There's adult-only themes. It's weird. It's gross. So it's trashy. It's garbage. Garbology, which is a real word, mind you. So yeah, very excited to read that coming up. I've got the Kindle version. So we start out with August 16th, Letters to the Purple Satin Killer by Joshua Chaplinsky. I've heard a lot about this book, and I love the cover very, very, very much. And this is one I wanted to pick up. I should still pick up. I just have had a lot of reading lately with review copies and other really cool patron pick winning books and other books that I just have wanted to get to. And the next month looks pretty tight too. So I don't know, this might be one that I'll put on a wish list, or I'll pick up and it will sit on the shelf, unfortunately, for a little while till I get to it. But the Pennsylvania native brutalized his way into the zeitgeist during the early part of the new millennium, leaving a trail of corpses across 5 states before his eventual arrest. All told, Williker was responsible for the rape and murder of 23 women, and it is suspected in the deaths of dozens more. His calling card, a torn piece of fabric found on or inside the bodies of his victims, helped popularize his now ubiquitous nickname, the Purple Satin Killer. In the years following his arrest, Jonas Williker received hundreds of letters in prison. Collected here, these letters offer a unique glimpse into a depraved mind through a human lens, including contributions from family, the bereaved, self-possessed fans. They represent a chilling portrait of the American psyche, skewering a media-obsessed culture where murderers are celebrities to be revered. What you learn about this man from these letters will shock you, but not as much as what you learn about yourself, which I highly doubt. I don't know. It's a fiction book, right? But it sounds like, you know, natural born killers kind of thing, but not told through the media, like quite a bit of that movie is, but told through letters. I'm pretty interested to read this, although part of me wants it to just be a straight on novel, and that's probably why I didn't run to pick it up. August 20th has Clown in the Cornfield 3, Church of Frendo by Adam Caesar, and that is pre-ordered. It's on its way. Like I said, I've got a lot of reading that I've already planned out, unfortunately, which makes it pretty tight for new books coming in. Quinn has just survived yet another bloody run-in with the murderous clown Frendo, but somehow she still knows this won't be the last. Tired of being hunted and seeing innocent people hurt, Quinn believes the only way to beat the horror is to take justice into her own hands and stop the Frendo followers herself. Little does she know that this path will take her across cornfields and state lines. If only it would come up to Canada. We have a lot of corn here. To where she will have to face the most dangerous and bloody menace yet, the true believers. So the true cult of Frendo. I want this to be like the Chucky franchise and just keep going on forever, but we're already at the cult phase, right? But I really liked the last two books, the first book, the second book, really good. I am very interested to see the cult aspect played up in this third book. Also on August 20th, we have Dead Children's Playground by James Cain. And I really like this premise. I really like the cover of this book as well. It reminds me a little skewing YA. From the description though, it sounds a little darker. Kylie Macklin is eager to live a normal life, freshly moved from Florida to Alabama and finally in remission from cancer. The optimistic 9-year-old is used to dodging her overprotective mother's warnings. So when a new playmate invites her to hang out, the happy girl thinks nothing of the playground being located in a graveyard for young victims of the Spanish flu and a local serial killer. It's like it got pretty dark there. I don't know, kids could handle, like young adult, of course, can handle that sort of stuff. I just want it to get very dark, and I don't really have an indication of how dark we get here in The Dead Children's Playground. Also, not knowing how dark this is going to get, I am very interested in this book. I want to say it's an instant buy. However, I already have a whole lot of books to buy, so I think this will be part of the poll. Pay the Piper by George A. Romero and Daniel Krauss. So Daniel Krauss found this half-finished novel in the papers in the George Romero collection at the Pennsylvania University. Alligator Point, Louisiana, population 141. Young Renee Pontiac has heard stories of the Piper, a murderous swamp entity haunting the bayou her entire life. But now the legend feels horrifically real. Children are being taken and gruesomely slain. To resist, Pontiac and the town's desperate denizens will need to acknowledge the sins of their ancestors, the infamous slave traders, the pirates Lafitte. If they don't, it's time to pay the piper. So very interested in this, not only because it's posthumous work by George A. Romero, which we're probably not going to get a heck of a lot more of. I really like Daniel Krauss and I really like what he's done with the legacy, as well as his own writing. So yeah, I think this will be a really good gift for those who are George Romero fans. Maybe not zombie fans, but it would help complete a collection that way. And if you've not read any Daniel Krauss, George Romero mashup stuff, or Daniel Krauss himself, definitely pick this up. Then starting with September 10th, we have Fears, Tales of Psychological Horror, edited by Ellen Datlow. Far beneath the mere supernatural lives something worse, the depths of human depravity. Your child is sacrificed in compensation for your social misstep. Okay, that's a big fear. You complete a sick game to save your loved ones. Pretty fearful. Your mom is insane, your dad is dying, your brother is not your brother, and you're stuck in the same house until one of or all of you are dead. Okay. Escape room could be like a fear, but like for real this time. In her newest landmark anthology, Ellen Datlow has unearthed 21 exemplary tales of what people should fear the most: other people. Okay, I get where they're going there. Very interested always in Ellen Datlow edited anthologies. I'm a fan of the year's best horror. That's usually where I spill my money, Ellen Datlow wise, but once in a while an anthology comes along that really speaks to me. This one's getting close. I might put it on the poll. Also on September 10th, we have Incarnate by Richard Thomas. I love the cover of this and I like the premise. I don't know. Maybe this will go on the poll too. I can't just keep putting all the books on the poll, but oh well. Sebastian Pana is a sin eater, a shaman-like figure who can absolve the dead of their transgressions before they move on to the afterlife. But when a terror in the fabric of reality allows hideous beasts to invade a small Arctic town that he calls home, Sebastian must wage battle with them in the only way he knows how, by unleashing the power of sin itself. See, it sounds really good. Mother Monster strives to save the dying land around her, and a young Inuit boy, haunted by Sebastian's fate, risks everything to forge a new way forward for the desperate vestiges of humanity. So yeah, I like Arctic horror, I like snowy horror, I like cold northern horror, and Richard Thomas is a good writer, so very interested to check this out. Loving the cover very much, and this cosmic nature of it all. Still on September 10th, and really cool covers, we have Sleep Tight, a novel by J.H. Mackert. Now, it's not as artistic as the previous one, it's this typography that I like so much, and I will say that almost all the covers in this entire list are fantastic, especially nearing the end. Father Silence once terrorized the rural town of Twisted Tree, disguising himself as a priest to prey on the most vulnerable members of society. When police finally found his house of horrors, they uncovered 19 bodies and one survivor, a boy now locked away in a hospital for the criminally insane. It's weird because he doesn't sound like a criminal, he sounds like a victim, but okay. Nearly two decades later, Father Silence is finally put to death, but by the next morning, the detective who worked on the original arrest is found dead. A new serial killer is taking credit for the murder and calling himself the Outcast. The detective's daughter, Tess, a detective herself, is haunted by childhood trauma and horrified by the death of her father and the resurgence of Father Silence's legacy. When Tess's own daughter is kidnapped by the Outcast, Tess is forced to face the worst fears and long-buried memories with no leads to follow. She travels back to Twisted Tree. Of course, it's always a hometown homecoming, isn't it? To visit the boy who survived and see what secrets might be buried in the tangled web of his broken mind. Now, often when there's a very long synopsis like that, I like to rewrite them to tighten it up a little bit, but I like that. I want to read that book. There's so many books I want, I have to put that one on the poll too. Same with this one, because I can't just buy every book. I want to though, it's tough. I get it when people say, darn you for telling us about all these awesome books, now I want to buy them all. I get it. I'm in the exact same boat with William by Mason Coyle. This book, it's like Andrew Niedermeyer's pin in many ways, you'll see. Henry is a brilliant engineer who, after untold hours spent in his home lab, has achieved the breakthrough of his career. He's created an artificially intelligent consciousness. He calls the half-formed robot William. No one knows about William. Henry's agoraphobia keeps him inside the house, and his fixation on the project keeps him in the attic, away from everyone, including his pregnant wife, Lily. It's amazing to me that he has a wife so far. When Lily's co-workers show up wanting to finally meet Henry and see the new house and the smartest of smart homes, you know, it would be, considering his engineering career, Henry decides to introduce them to William, and things go from strange to much worse. Soon, Henry and Lily discover the security upgrades intended to keep danger out of the house are even better at locking everything in. So, yeah, very interested. It's like Pin Plus. And another really cool cover, September 13th, which is not a Tuesday. Almost all of the big releases happen on Tuesdays. This is a Friday the 13th. Flowers from the Void by Johnny Washington. 13 Dark Tales told through the lenses of Black female and queer narrators, among others, which burrow deep into the heart of the gothic to challenge the conventional nightmare. Flowers from the Void unburies the haunted labyrinth of chilling alternate realities eerily similar to our own. A high school freshman lured into a sinister pact with a classmate that will cost him more than he could ever imagine. A grieving African witch prepares for initiation into a 17th century Salem coven of white women. A girl with no shadow befriends one. So yeah, really interesting, unique stories told by unique lenses. And I like the idea of queering the gothic. So yeah, Flowers from the Void by Johnny Washington may be one on your list if that is your thing. Now, this is one that was on my list. I'm not sure if it's going to remain there. The book is called Hampton Heights, One Harrowing Night in the Most Haunted Neighborhood in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Big long title. The Hampton Heights part caught my eye, as did the cover, because it sort of reminds me of, I'm not sure what, a podcast, maybe Night Vale. On a cold winter's evening in 1987, six middle school paper boys wander an unfamiliar Milwaukee neighborhood, selling newspaper subscriptions fueled by their manager Kevin's promises of cash bonuses and dinner at Burger King. But the freaks come out at night in Hampton Heights. Set out into the neighborhood in pairs, the boys will encounter primordial monsters and triumph over them. It's the end triumph over them that makes me be like, oh, this is kids on bikes saving the neighborhood. Sigmund, who is bused to a white school, is stuck with Joel, a white kid who idolizes black culture. Mark, who's wrestling with his sexuality, joins his secret crush Ryan. Nishu and Al are outsiders, One is second generation immigrant and the other is a poor kid in a rich school. Over the course of one eventful evening, the three pairs will encounter the wild things of Hampton Heights, werewolves, witches with a centuries-old story to tell, and a creepy ancient monster who feeds on memories. Meanwhile, Kevin is having an adventure of his own, seducing a beautiful woman in the neighborhood's tavern, but who is actually in control? Well, probably the kids, the six paper boys or whatever. Like, I was really taken with this, and I don't know what description I read first. Maybe it was the first paragraph of all this that caught my eye initially, but then I was like, oh, it sounds really young. It sounds almost middle grade. So yeah, it's kind of young for me, but hey, if you know somebody who's just getting into horror or wants something a little more calm, Hampton Heights might be for them. On the list coming out September 17th is Midwestern Gothic by Scott Thomas. I have absolutely thoroughly enjoyed this, and a review will be coming soon. In The Door in the Field, a construction worker's bad day becomes far worse by night when drinks at an off-the-books bar send him down an unforeseeably bloody path. In The Boy in the Woods, something evil has infected the counselors at a summer camp, and a young boy will have to do anything he can to survive the night. In One Half of a Child's Face, a woman spying on her daughter and ex-husband notices an odd painting hanging in an empty apartment, one that seems to call to the building's children. It's very creepy. In Wear Your Secret Like a Stone, a big box store clerk learns that her book pick for Halloween display echoes a dark secret hidden beneath the idyllic facade of her hometown. Really enjoyed that. I like the whole collection, and it does feature some characters from Kill Creek in each story. In this collection, Scott Thomas digs his hands into the soil of the American heartland and establishes himself as a master of the Midwestern Gothic. Hence the title. Yeah, coming soon. And coming up September 24th is Devils Kill Devils by Johnny Compton, another name that is very familiar. I've read his Spite House book. Sarita has been watched over by a guardian angel her entire life. She keeps him a secret, but calls him Angelo. Secrets can't stay buried forever. When Angelo murders someone she loves, guardian angels don't do that, Sarita. Sarita begins to see what's really been lurking in the shadows surrounding her when Angelo kills someone she loves. And she will have to embrace the evil within if she hopes to make it out alive. Devils are a tricksy thing, so maybe that's what it is and not a guardian angel at all. And, you know, it could be the fallen angel. Who knows? We'll find out in Devils Kill Devils coming September 24th. Unless we buy a different book. Also coming September 24th, which will be on the poll because this is one I really want to buy, like all of the other books that are going to be on the poll. The Ravening by Daniel Church. Janet's life has always been a fight. From the traumatic and mysterious loss of her mother on a dark woodland road when she was 15 to an abusive and controlling boyfriend that she's barely escaped, she has learned that trust hurts you in the end. Now Jenna has found what she hopes is happiness with her new girlfriend, Holly. But the world is full of darkness, some of it ancient, some of it close to home, evil, and those who serve it will not let Jenna go. This has been likened to Stephen Graham Jones, specifically for those who are fans of The Only Good Indians. The cover kind of speaks to that, but yeah, I'm interested, definitely. I think that this could be very dark. For those who are fashion victims, fans of Regina St. Clair's horror fiction, or those who just have this fashion-shaped hole in your horror subgenres and want more fashion horror, because I know fashion horror is, you know, a very underserved subgenre that both men and women adore, comes on September 24th. Tiny Threads, a novel by Lillian Rivera. And I really like the cover, even though it really reminds me of Grey Dog. And this is like the new trend, I think, this monochrome thing with like a black and white image, just taking up a little bit of space in the middle of it. I don't know how to describe the cover outside of that, but yeah, Tiny Threads. Fashion-obsessed Samara is living her dream with a high-powered job at legendary designer Antonio Mora's firm, a new home in sunny California, and a wealthy love interest, Brandon. However, as a big show approaches, Samara's dream life turns into a nightmare. The mounting pressure leads her to hear voices and see unexplained things beyond mere stress or alcohol. Samara's unraveling psyche uncovers troubling hints that her new city at the House of Mata may be built on secrets and lies. She must reveal the dark truths hidden in this glamorous world before they consume her. I find that this fashion horror thing is more prevalent in film, with films like Starry Eyes, or film adjacent to that, like Black Swan. And there's not as much horror in fiction, in books, that I've read, or that gets, you know, on lists like this, great glamorous lists like this. But yeah, if you're into fashion horror, I think Tiny Threads will help. So I am not going to pick it up, but I would love to hear how this book is. And September 24th is Where I End by Sophie White, and this is where we end. This is the last book on the list, except for a couple more coming up next month that I want to mention. At night, my mother creaks. The house creaks along with her. Sometimes in the morning, we find her in places. We never see her move. We just come upon her. Aelin is cursed. She has no friends. She's never gone to school. She has never left this windswept, craggy isle off the coast of Ireland. Her mother is cursed. A silent wreck Aelin calls the bed thing. Alongside her grandmother, Aelin's days are an endless monotony of feeding, changing, and caring for the bed thing. Their island seems cursed, whispering secrets only Aelin hears. Then Rachel, a vivacious artist from the mainland, arrives with her colicky newborn. Rachel arouses yearnings that Aelin can not fully comprehend. Soon the unfolding of her mother's secret tragedy and Aelin's pursuit of her own dark desires are both destined to unleash a maelstrom upon all three of their lives. Okay. There's a lot going on there, kind of, but nothing at all. A girl is trapped in an island off the coast of Ireland taking care of her sickly mother, and a woman arrives. Basically. I like it, though. I love the cover of this. It is so simple. And I'm my interest is piqued, so it's probably going to be on the list for the poll. Is this a book that sounds interesting to you as well? I mean, it sounds so very simplistic. It sounds quite gothic, very femme-centric gothic at that. So kind of interested there, just on that alone. So that's 16 books coming out in September mainly. Two that I'm looking forward to talking about coming up next month in October. It starts with Coup de Grâce by Sofia Ajram. It's an experimental horror book. If you like House of Leaves, you're supposed to like Coup de Grâce. And The Black Hunger by Nicholas Pullen. That's a local author to me here, an Ontario author. And I'm very interested to hear this. Black Hunger, the cover is amazing. That's 16, 17, 18 books, and God knows what else will be coming out in September. There's a big list. I only picked what caught my eye. So if there's anything that you're reading coming up the next month, getting ready for spooky season, as it were, let me know in the comments below. Or if there's anything here that you've already read, tell me all about it. Thank you so much for watching, and have an ooky spooky day.